Hi, this is Yannis again. This lecture will continue on mesh networking. This is the second part. So let's summarize a bit what we discussed in the previous lecture. Essentially, we discussed about different kind of topologies. We saw in the previous parts of the course how we can use devices that directly connect to the internet via some kind of a local wireless access point or via an Ethernet network directly to get, let's say, an IP address, either a public IP or an IP behind a NAT gateway, where essentially these devices were capable of directly communicating with our cloud services and carry out packet transmissions directly. So this is depicted in this picture through this home network topology. And then we also examined the case of a star network. In particular, we worked on these networks with LoRa networks for long-range connectivity, where there is this intermediate gateway, these special purpose devices that are deployed throughout the area of interest, and they allow the devices to connect to them and then through them essentially transmit packets to the internet. And you also worked with these devices during the third assignment, where essentially you were forwarding the packets received through the gateways to your MQTT broker. So last from the previous lecture, we started looking into a different kind of topology, the so-called mesh networks, where essentially we have multi-hop networks that go essentially beyond just two-hop networks like in star topology. So the devices, in contrast to home networks, they are not directly connected to the gateway device within, as we say, one hop. Neither they use a gateway, an intermediate gateway that is, let's say, in two hops. So now they are not in two hops, but they could be positioned further away, and for this reason we say that they create a mesh network, a multi-hop network. Here, typical technologies are Zigbee. We also have the Bluetooth that is now enabling mesh networking capabilities. We can also use Wi-Fi in ad hoc mode to realize this kind of networks. And here, the way that we view this topology by using some basic graph theory is using a generic topology, a generic graph topology, where the devices may have one or more roles. The most basic role, of course, is that of the endpoint. This is a device that simply generates and receives messages. It is not participating in any other way in the network creation and the communication of messages. Then we have the so-called gateway devices, which role is to forward packets from one network interface to another. So these gateway devices typically have access to at least two kinds of networks, like, for example, Zigbee and Wi-Fi, or they might have a cable connection to the internet, and then also Zigbee or Bluetooth, a collection of different interfaces. And finally, we also have the routers. These are nodes which essentially are willing to forward packets between end nodes and gateways. And Fisica, of course, repeater nodes can also generate messages by themselves. They can also receive messages. It really depends on the kind of deployment, but they are essential in order to support the overall network operation. So in such a kind of mesh network, the basic, the most fundamental problem that we need to solve before going to more, let's say, advanced, realizing more advanced applications, of course, is to enable communication. Clearly, when two nodes are next to each other, so when they are within the wireless transmission range of each other, clearly then, by just transmitting their message, they will be able to receive it. This is what we've been doing with LoRa, this is what we are doing from our mobile phone to transmit a message via Bluetooth or via Wi-Fi. However, the question is, what's the situation when the two nodes are not close to each other? So here, the question is how the nodes of the network will coordinate in order for a packet, a single packet, from a source node S will eventually reach a destination node D. In the previous lecture, we examined different kind of possible variations, but then we worked with a basic version, a simple version, which nevertheless is really interesting and creates several problems that are not trivial to address. So our first assumption here is that we have a fully symmetric node environment. That means that all nodes essentially have the same wireless capabilities, they have the same transmission range. So if A can send a message to B, if B can receive a message from A, then similarly, symmetrically, A can also receive the messages from B. And then we said that the nodes are static. We didn't examine the possibility of mobility. We said that all nodes are willing to act as repeaters. There are no malicious nodes here. We don't want to look into cases where, of course, there are issues of trust and security. We also considered the case where all nodes have unique identifiers. We don't have anonymity in our basic version. And then there is no noise from the surrounding environment. So essentially, messages are not... every transmission is successfully received from the other side. And in this way, again, we can focus on the coordination, on the distributed, let's say, coordination of the network. So essentially, this is a distributed environment. Each node is acting completely independently. There is no centralized control. Any kind of coordination needs to be carried out through message exchanges. And here, the most simple protocol that solves the basic communication problem is the so-called flooding protocol, where essentially all nodes starting from the source node are, upon receiving this packet P, they retransmit it, they forward it to their neighbors. So we can view this as a kind of a wave within a lake. When we throw a pebble at a particular part of the lake, there is a wave that is created starting from the point where the pebble entered the water and then gradually moving towards the boundaries of the lake. Or if we want to view this as the floor where we throw a bucket of water, the water falls under the bucket and then spreads towards the boundaries of the floor. So in this way, flooding operates. The packet maintains a sequence number, which is used so that when a node receives a packet based on the sequence number, it will not re-forward it And this way, we will not have a continuous retransmission of the packet. Essentially, each node will just forward the packet only once. So essentially, the format of the packet is the source node address, the destination node address, and the sequence number. These three parameters uniquely identify the packet, and then, of course, the payload. We saw that essentially flooding succeeds in this simple version under the assumptions we made to deliver the packet, even when essentially we don't have any idea on how our network is structured, where the destination node is located, and so on. And essentially here we said that in some sense it is also there is no guarantee that the node will arrive in this, since we don't know if the destination node actually is within the same connected component of the sender node. So if one node is really far away, and in this sense the network is partitioned, of course there is no way to carry out a wireless broadcast that will be received by this node. So this is natural in some sense. That we say that nodes that are not reachable from S, they will not receive the packets. The positive aspect of flooding, of course, is simplicity. As we said, there is no need to learn anything about the topology. And of course, there is high reliability in the sense that the packet will be delivered possibly by multiple paths. So if one fails, then most probably one of the others will succeed. Now, in terms of the disadvantages, the most important one, of course, is the fact that there is a high overhead. Whenever we want to transmit one packet, essentially we are potentially involving all the nodes in the network. And here, of course, we are in a theoretical point of view. Our perspective here is confined. When we move to more realistic environments, or when we go directly to the real world, there, of course, these assumptions that we have made regarding the wireless transmissions, the existence of noise, the symmetry of links, and so on, do not hold exactly like that. And in that sense, it is hard to implement these concurrent broadcasts without further increasing the overhead of the protocol. So indeed, flooding is a simple approach, but there are also additional mechanisms that need to be implemented in order to be, realizable, can be practically applied to real environments. Yet, even like that, it still is a simple protocol. And one of the most, serious problems, the very first problem that we need to solve here is when we have nodes concurrently transmitting the packet received. So consider that when S transmits a message, then in some sense all the nodes that receive this message will be synchronized based on this event. So if they try to retransmit and in this way forward the packet to their neighbors immediately, then with a high probability we are going to experience this exposed terminal problem, or the so-called broadcast storm. There are different techniques to solve it. For example, we can introduce random delays, the so-called backoff, a random backoff to each node, and in this way try to create some distance between the concurrent transmissions. Or we can implement some kind of an RTS CTS mechanism. There are different approaches here, and in this way we can bypass to a large extent this problem. Given this discussion, the next thing we discussed was we considered, okay, fine, we cannot use flooding for all the messages in the network. This is completely unrealistic. We cannot assume that all the networks, all the nodes will participate in the transmission of only one packet. So what we said here is, okay, let's use flooding in order to try to discover a bit, to learn a bit of the topology. So since the nodes are not mobile, maybe we have some time here. The network will not be extremely short-lived. So it's worth the effort of exchanging a few messages using flooding in order to understand our neighbors and maybe the neighbors of our neighbors, and so on and so forth. So in this sense, use some special control packets that are small. They are exchanged infrequently in order to discover routes and paths that can then be used directly to send data packets that will avoid essentially flooding. So the idea, of course, here is that this overhead that will be created by exchanging these control packets, of course, will be amortized when we want to transmit a significantly larger volume of data packets. So, having done this observation, we went into the discussion of different kind of protocols for the unicast routing problem. This is now a different problem, a much more, let's say, complicated problem compared to the basic communication problem, in the sense that here now we have different aspects that we want to address, and there are issues of efficiency and optimization of the network. So here we want to forward packets between the so-called single source, single destination pairs, the source destination pairs, and we may have multiple source destination pairs, and the routing, this unicast routing, in fact, is a network protocol that dictates how the packets should be communicated, how the nodes of the network are coordinated so that the packets reach their destination with specific efficiency measures, like, for example, in the shorter time, with the highest success rate, achieving the highest throughput, or reducing the energy efficiency of the network. So essentially we have two functions, two main functions. One function is to discover the topology and, based on the network discovery, identify the route, the best route given specific criteria for the different source destination pairs. And then, based on the selected route, or maybe multiple routes depending on the protocol, make sure that the messages are delivered to the destination. So this implies that here we need to monitor the delivery of the messages, identify whether there are errors during the transmission, potentially fix the errors in the routes, or find alternative paths, carry out some flow control, and so on and so forth. So this is a much more complex problem, as I keep repeating. We need to avoid network congestions, we need to cope with failures, and of course in realistic environments we need to identify security breaches. And all these are done by coordinating with the nodes, really some of them far away from the central, let's say, gateway. In the case of flooding, all these problems did not exist because we were just transmitting, let's say, completely blindly forwarding packets in the network. But now, suddenly, in order to become more efficient, we have to solve these sub-problems, let's say. And on the website, I have provided a link to the book of Bertsekas and Gallagher, which is, let's say, a very, very basic, a very, very, let's say, fundamental book on data networks. It is introducing the most important topics related to the problem of routing and what are the challenges that we need to address, and I highly recommend it for those of you that want to go deeper into the networking aspects of the class. So indeed, the selection of the routes are based on different so-called performance measures. Basic performance measures are related to the quantity and the quality of service. So here again, there is a lot of work done related to the quality of service, related to energy efficiency, and so on and so forth. And of course, we are not going to go into the details in this course, but I'm sure that under different courses that focus on networks, either wired or wireless networks or satellite networks, study these kinds of aspects. Now, having said this, under the unicast routing problem, we saw the dynamic source routing protocol. This is a so-called reactive protocol. When a node S wants to send the packet to a node D, and there is no route, the routing protocol is a kind of a daemon that continuously runs within the stack of node S. It has an internal dictionary, as we discussed, the so-called routing table. When one of the higher level applications wants to transmit a message, like for example our sensor application that we developed, they want to transmit a message, the routing table is examined. If there is already an entry within the routing table, then we examine the routing table and we forward the packet using the information that we found in the routing table. If there is no such entry, then we initiate the so-called route discovery. In DSR, the nodes, essentially, the routing table provides information about the complete path that the packet needs to follow in order to reach the end, the final destination. So, the sending node either knows a complete path or does not know any other path. So the routing table has a simple structure. For each destination node, there is an ordered list of nodes that make up the path. Now, the route discovery that we examined in details in the previous lecture is using the flooding mechanism to transmit, to broadcast throughout the network this control message, the route request control message, which gradually is forwarded from node to node. It's flooded towards all the nodes of the network. And when a node receives this control message, it appends its own identifier before forwarding it to the next node. So in this way, when the destination receives the route request message, it contains within the message itself contains the path that the message followed in order to reach the destination D. So now D creates the so-called root reply methods, which is another control method. And within these root reply methods, it includes the reverse of the root collected from the root request method. So there is a path from S to D that the root request method followed in order to reach D. So D reverses this path so that the root reply will essentially go back to S. And in this way, S will be notified that indeed D is reachable. So they are within the same network partition. And now S and D can use this path in order to exchange data. So essentially data now is based on this path that we have just discovered. And the data packet format here is comprised of a packet header and the payload. The packet header has, of course, the source node address, the destination node address, and the list of the actual path, the list of node addresses that that make up this path that the packet will follow in order to reach the destination. Now, there are many different elements here that we can modify, and indeed there are many variations of the DSR protocol to deal with different kind of versions with different assumptions and so on. The basic advantage here is that the routes need to be maintained only by the SD pair. So in that sense, if one of the intermediate node, let's say, gets a restart, a restart failure and loses its internal memory, then this does not create any overhead for the root maintenance. We also saw how we can introduce root caching mechanisms to further reduce the overhead of the flooding process. And we also discussed about how we can identify multiple paths in order to increase reliability. So we do not need necessarily to send each packet through the same path, but we can diverse essentially delivery of messages. We also discussed about the disadvantages. Essentially, in networks of large diameter, where the distance, the length of the path between S and D are long, are big, then the packet header grows really a lot. So if, for example, we are using 4 bits or 8 bits for the unique addresses of the nodes, then clearly if we want to carry out, let's say, 6 or 8 hops to reach the destination, then the header has a significant size. And significant in the sense that when we are dealing with Zigbee networks, the total packet size is limited, around 130 bytes. So, of course, we cannot, if we want to transmit large data, then this will lead to a fragmentation of the messages into multiple packets. Of course, we are still flooding the network with root requests. This, of course, exposes us to the terminal problem. And also, improvements that we saw create extra problems. The caches need to be regularly cleared to avoid the case where we have essentially stale information. So this more or less summarizes DSR. As we said, it is one of the first protocols introduced. And a bit later, another protocol was presented, the AODV protocol, the ad hoc on demand distance vector routing protocol. This is a protocol that has been studied extensively in the bibliography. It is also a decentralized protocol. But here, essentially, the main difference between AODV and DSR is the fact that we don't want to have the complete path. We want to follow a next hop policy here. So each node knows only the next hop and not the entire route. Of course, there are some benefits and there are some disadvantages between these two approaches. So clearly, we gain some, we lose some. Now, the routing table has a different kind of structure. Here we have the destination node, and then just the next hop, the node address of one of our neighbors that we will use in order to forward the message, and then this node will forward it further until it finally arrives at the final destination. We also keep a destination sequence number to determine the freshness of the entry, and also set a lifetime for each routing entry so that we can remove it after a certain amount of time and search for new ones. Now, the route request goes again in the same mechanism. We are using a flooding mechanism. However, we are not appending the node addresses into the route request message, so the size of the route request is fixed. However, every time a node receives a route request, it automatically updates the local routing table. So now all the nodes of the network are updating their routing tables to reflect this path from S, initially from S to D. So gradually the nodes are building up the routing tables. And in a similar way, the routing reply is a kind of an acknowledgement, since again it does not include any information regarding the path. The nodes now receiving this route reply are propagating this message by reversing the entry that they already have in the routing table. So essentially, we are acknowledging the fact that a route was found, and like that, we have completed the route discovery phase. Now, of course, the benefit is that routes are not included in the packet headers, but the S, the source and the destination node contain entries that are very, let's say, shorter in size. However, all the nodes on the path need to maintain also information about this path. And as a matter of fact, since the route request messages are flooded, all the messages of the network contain some kind of information, even though they might be completely unrelated to these two nodes, even if they are really far away from these two nodes. So there are some, of course, disadvantages. If a node restarts and loses its routing table, then again the path is completely lost, since no node contains the complete information. So you see that there are again positive benefits and problematics created every time we follow a different approach. Based on these two protocols, now we will move on to examine a different approach here, a different approach where essentially we will try to avoid flooding for discovering the topology of the network. Here it is important to nevertheless keep in mind the fact that we are still relying on a mechanism, a kind of an underlying protocol here, a basic protocol, which is the so-called ECHO protocol, This is a neighborhood discovery protocol where all nodes periodically broadcast a special control message, a special control packet, the so-called hello packet. This is the most simple way in order to understand that you are close to another node. So, of course, these messages add to network contention, but there is no other way to realize which are our nearest neighbors. There are mechanisms to limit these messages, so we don't have to continuously broadcast, let's say, every 5 seconds, every minute or so, depending, of course, on the dynamicity of the network, this message. There is, for example, the trickle protocol that is proposing some logarithmic back-off delays. There are different kind of protocols here that we can use to limit these messages. But indeed, it is important to at least learn, at least know which are our neighbors. So having said this, we now let's discuss a bit the ring reversal algorithm by starting with the very first algorithms presented by Gaffney and Bertsekas back in the 80s, which was not about wireless networks. It was more about graph theoretic, let's say, a graph theoretic approach to this problem. So here again, we follow the core assumption that we have a symmetric environment, links are bidirectional, and now we introduce a kind of a state for links. So till now, the links didn't have a state. We only stored information on nodes, but for the link reversal algorithms, we are going to assume that we can also store information on links. Now, this is interesting because in the previous lecture, I emphasized a lot on the fact that the very notion of wireless link is very problematic in the sense that there is no such thing as a link. It is a theoretical an abstraction of the way that the wireless channel operates. So in contrast to normal, let's say, landline fixed networks where we have cable connections and where, of course, these cables are the links between the nodes, in a wireless environment, there is no such connection. It's just a channel, which is, and I'm putting a lot of emphasis on this, so just to be clear on that, it's not something that is continuously there. And of course, we have experienced this when we are using our Wi-Fi connections or when we are using our smartphones. Without changing our position, without modifying something from our software, connectivity might be completely lost. So it might go faster, slower, or completely disappeared. So it's not exactly a link. And not only till now we made this assumption that there is a link, but now we are extending this assumption and saying that we can also store information on this link. Okay, so as a matter of fact, it's not so difficult in the sense that what we want to do here is to introduce a kind of an information which is agreed between the two end nodes. So this can be, we can introduce a distributed mechanism, a very, very simple distributed mechanism where when there is a link between node A and node B, in order to represent the state of this node, both A and B are locally storing this value on their local memory. And then if either node A or node B wants to change this value, then they just inform by transmitting a packet their neighbor B about the new information. So this state is stored, this link state is stored at the nodes, and of course it has to be agreed between the end nodes of a wireless link. So there are, for example, protocols that allow us to do this using building upon the echo protocol we just discussed. So we are not only transmitting our ID to our neighbors, but we are also transmitting pairs of values between ourselves and our neighbors, which essentially work towards the realization of this abstraction. So in the link reversal algorithms, we have the notion of a logical direction. Links are directed now. And we build for each destination node D a directed acyclic graph. So now nodes, when we have a node that wants to transmit a message to D, if there is no directed acyclic graph, or we say a DAG exists, if a DAG does not exist, then essentially we initialize the construction of a DAG where the destination node becomes the root of this DAG. Now, here in sensor networks, for example, where we have multiple nodes that are transmitting, let's say, messages to a given gateway, because this is the most common mode of operation in the network, of course, this DAG will be beneficial to many nodes that also want to transmit their data packets to the gateway. Another interesting property is that this directed acyclic graph will have shortest paths, of course, under the assumptions we made in real-world environments, this might not be the case. And of course, the basic idea here now is to avoid flooding and to limit the updates within the vicinity of a broken link. So if something changes, we wish to make a few updates to the nearby nodes to make local changes, and these changes will not be propagated further. So this also is in the category of local algorithms that have the property of scaling to large networks in a much better way. So here you can see an example of a destination-oriented DAG, as we say. So the root of the DAG is destination D, where essentially all links are incoming links. So starting from any node in the network, the only thing we need to do is follow one outgoing link, or if you want, we can follow all outgoing links, and by continuously following outgoing links, we will eventually reach the final destination. The algorithm is very, very simple. The nodes that do not have any outgoing link, so starting from the source node S, we just notify our neighbors that we wish to set up a DAG routed to destination node D. And since we don't have any outgoing link, we reverse all incoming links to point towards our neighbors. And like that, progressively, by proceeding in iteration, all the nodes check their links. If they don't maintain any outgoing link, they reverse all the incoming links. And essentially, this algorithm eventually, given that there are no failures in the network, eventually converges and eventually succeeds in building the directed acyclic graph as it is shown here in the example. And of course, if you check out the paper, the original paper of Gaffney and Bertsekas, that it is connected to on the lecture on the course website, you can also check out the proof. It is an iterative proof that essentially is based on the principle that we don't have any message failures, and the network is synchronous. Now, what happens when there is a failure? So what happens, for example, when the connection between D and G is lost? Then we have this reversing of the nodes. I'm not sure why this is my computer is possessed. I don't know why this is happening, but it seems that it is acting automatically. Let me try to reverse this. I will pause now the video. Okay, the problem is fixed. Let's continue. Sorry about that. So let's say that the link between G and D is lost. So this could again be the case when there is some noise, or maybe D moves slightly away from G. So now G realizes that there are no outgoing links, and since G is not a destination of this DAG, it reverses all incoming links. Now the same holds for E and F. Again, they understand that all the links are incoming while they are not the root of the DAG, so they also reverse all incoming links. Now G goes back to the previous situation, and now B is also activated. So here you see that we have for each round there is some nodes are active. This is how the protocol works, and active nodes take actions in order to correct their fix their state, and this is more or less how the proof that of the algorithm is correct, the correctness holds. Essentially, we prove that when there is a problem, when we don't have a DAG, because now this is not a DAG, there is at least one active node, while when we have constructed a DAG, then node is activated. All nodes are deactivated. So here G again is active, and also B now is active. They reverse their links. Now we see that E will not be reactivated. However, F will have to be reactivated. And due to B, also A will be activated. So F reverses the links, but this will not create a problem to G. A reverses all incoming links, but this will not create a problem to B, since there is still this outgoing link to E, and then C will not make any changes, since there's already a link that goes to D. So you see that essentially the original event that removed this link between D and G led to a series of changes that at the end reached stabilized. We can also use this terminology. The network has stabilized, and now we have a graph again that maintains the properties. It is rooted on the destination node D, and it is a directed acyclic graph. So this is how link reversal works, and this is the resulting the resulting graph. So essentially, there is the algorithm indeed is correct, unless there is a partition in the network, and as we will see immediately next, we have essentially a ring reversal that continues indefinitely. The nodes are continuously and indefinitely activated for the partition, which essentially is disconnected from destination node D. While for the partition that includes D, of course, there the mechanism will eventually stabilize and will not create problems. However, for the partition that does not include D, there we will have a continuous waste of resources. And this is an example. So we have the links between C and D and A and B that are lost. Maybe also the link from D to G. So starting from the original network, these links here are lost. Three links are lost. So now A realizes that all links are incoming, and G realizes that all links are incoming, so they reverse their incoming links. On the left side, the network that includes D, this partition, we are done. Now the directed acyclic graph is restored, while on the right part, on the right partition that does not include D, essentially we will continue this forever. So G reverses the links and E and F are activated. They reverse their links and now B and Z are activated, and this continues forever. This is the continuous essentially execution, and of course the waste of resources. The protocol does not include any kind of mechanism to identify this continuous loop. So essentially this is a problem that is not solved, and we have another protocol introduced in 1999, the temporary-ordered routing protocol, that essentially improves this link reversal method by detecting partitions and stopping all these essentially non-productive link reversals, this completely waste of resources. So here, the links, indeed they do have a direction, but we are assigning to the nodes a height. So you can imagine that the destination has the lowest height in our network, and all the other nodes have higher heights. So now, again, we can imagine that we have this different, we have this structure where what we want to do is just forward the message to the nodes with that are below us. Again, it's like throwing some water down the waterfall. So we just move further down into the structure. Now here paths may not be the shortest paths, but at least we don't have problems when there is a partition in the network. We can identify this partition, and the heights essentially are based on five values. Each node I maintains these five values. The first one is the so-called logical time. Tau is used for the logical time. It's a kind of a logical clock, for those of you that remember the Lamport clocks. OID is the unique ID of the node that identified, let's say, the fact that we are in carrying out this cyclic repetition. It is used for reference. Then R is the so-called reflection bit, And finally, delta is the propagation ordering parameter that altogether these four parameters allow us to identify loops and stop them. And finally, the last parameter, D, is the destination of the root of this DAG. So this is an example where again we have a partition. This is again a DAG centered on destination D. The link between A and D is lost. So now A, like in the previous case, will reverse the incoming links A and between A and B and A and C. Now B will do the same. Then it's it's for C to do the same thing. And when A returns essentially again, when B I understand that it is in a situation like previously so case, it will activate this reflection bit, this R bit, as we said, will set OID to its own ID, and in this way it will signal to A that there is an issue, and they will terminate. And then essentially they will completely remove this DAG, and they will stop trying to establish a connection to D, since there is no such connection. So this is the main idea of TORA. Again, we cannot go into the details. This is not the goal, to go into the details of all these different protocols. However, what we can say is that essentially we have on-demand creations of nodes. We use just one hop broadcasts instead of flooding. However, unfortunately, although this sounds as a good idea, at the end DSR and AODV outperform the performance of TORA in real-world networks. And in general, the performance degrades really fast when we are in mobile networks. So there is a propagation of local changes throughout the network, and at the end we do get an effect that is similar to the flooding. As we said, there are essentially this development of different approaches, different research initiatives for routing in wireless sensor networks have resulted. I mean, this is something, a process that goes on for more than 20 years, has resulted in many thousands of protocols introducing novel approaches. Some of them are completely new, some others are variations that try to improve and extend existing protocols so that they work in sub-cases. And of course, we also have surveys that try to compare different approaches. We have evaluation studies in order to understand how each protocol operates in comparison to other protocols under given conditions, using theoretical tools, experimental tools. Yet the question here is, how do we converge? Because at the end we want to choose one, let's say, protocol that will then become a kind of a standard for the internet, so that we can start building a common network. Otherwise, if we don't converge, we will end up with a fragmented landscape where products essentially are using different protocols, and they cannot create common, they cannot cooperate, let's say, if they are from different manufacturers. And of course, this is not something that adds value to our network, right? So Here, the internet, the way that we build the internet is through the Internet Engineering Task Force that is using different working groups. And under each working group, we have these mechanisms of RFCs, request for comments. These are technical reports, essentially, where they have unique numbers and versions. We cannot modify a version. The only way to do is to introduce a new version. And this is a public document which is released, again, with the purpose to provoke discussion within the community of engineers and researchers and scientists in an attempt to get feedback. So not all RFCs are standards. However, all protocols, standard protocols, start from an RFC. So you can check out, for example, HTTP, FTP, NTP, DNS, all these kinds of protocols have an RFC associated to them. So RFCs have a status. They can be informational, experimental, present a kind of a best current practice. They can be a standard, or they might be switched to historic status about protocols that are no longer used. And here we can see some examples. You can go to the website of the course, and then under lecture 19, I have included a link to the RFC that presents the DSR, the dynamic source routing protocol. So this is the proposal of done by Johnson and Maltz in 2007, and it is number 4728, and it is experimental under the network working group. So here we have a draft, and you see that this is an experimental, essentially, protocol for the internet community, which at the end didn't make it to become a standard. So it is interesting to see how a protocol is presented in a standard way. You see that a protocol that started presented in a paper, in a research paper that was about 10 pages, ends up in a document of about 100 pages, so that it is clearly presented, so that anyone can implement it and end up with a solution that is interoperable and hardware, let's say, independent. So initially we start by discussing the purpose of this document, the purpose of this protocol, and the goals. We have certain assumptions that are essentially the background, and then we provide an overview of the protocol by explaining how the mechanisms are working, root discovery, root mechanism, then the additional features that we have in our protocol to identify, for example, missing paths, detecting loops, and so on. And then we present the different data structures, the root cache, the root request table, and so on, under a different section. And of course, we also present the message formats and all the special cases for our headers. And then, having done this, we have a detailed operation, presentation of the details of the different processes when we want to process a generic packet, a root discovery packet, and so on and so forth. So this is the way that a protocol is presented. And at the end, of course, we also have references. We can go to the very bottom, and you can see here that we have references to the original protocols, and also to other protocols that have been used. So this is the original publication in 94 under this IEEE workshop on mobile computing systems and application. This was a workshop, and then a couple of years later it was described as part of a journal and also as part of a book in 96. We have the references that of course need to be specified in a very, very correct and formal way. And then you can see, of course, that we have a presentation of the packet structure, and we have a description of the headers with the fixed parts, the options. Now, in this, for example, you see that the root request, we have the option, and then we have the number of addresses, as we said, that constitute the path, the target address, and then we also have the source address. We may introduce a hop limit. We didn't discuss about this. And we have also a series of options that are encoded using 8 bits. And then again, we have the exact format of the root reply. And exactly like this, we also get the similar RFC for AODV. This was done a bit earlier, again under the same category. It is experimental, although AODV is implemented broadly for, let's say, mobile phones, for wireless network, for Linux systems, Windows systems, so we can use it even with Wi-Fi networks, and we can set up Wi-Fi mesh networks using AODV. Still, this is considered to be an experimental algorithm. It's not considered a standard for the internet. This is much shorter, it's just 37 pages, but it follows the same format. So we start by presenting the terminology, and then we also describe here the exact message format with the different parameters, and then of course after presenting the different formats, we get a detailed presentation of the way that the protocol operates and the different processes take place. And the same holds also for TORA. So TORA also is an RFC. This is under a different working group. This is not under the network working group. This is under the mobile ad hoc networks working group. So as we said, IETF has different working groups. And here Vincent Park and Corson in 2001 composed this specification, and you see that there are also different versions, and we can also quickly see the differences between the various versions. We have all these different RFCs, and of course the question is, how do we converge to just one? How do we end up with one solution that is proposed as the standard? And here, IETF essentially what it did, it created a new working group called the Routing Over Low Power and Lossy Networks. That was essentially realized that it's not about being mobile, but as a matter of fact, it's about being low power and lossy. So these are the so-called LLN networks. They have restricted processing power, they have restricted memory, they have limited energy, or maybe, okay, they might be connected to the power, but still they have limited processing capabilities. They are interconnected using a variety of links. One example, of course, is Wi-Fi, another one is Bluetooth, or 802.15.4, so it could be ZigBee, it could be Z-Wave, it could be different kinds of variations of 15.4. And the links now are characterized by high loss rates, low data rates, and instability. Of course, low data rates here, we are not referring to narrowband connections like LoRa networks. We are essentially at the level of 200, 100, maybe 80 kilobps. So it is, of course, slower than broadband internet, but certainly not as slow as LoRa long LP1 networks. So here, the task force composed out of researchers coming from academia, industry, and engineers working in the industry, for example, from Cisco, from Nokia, and so on, evaluated existing routing protocols, of course, under the scope of LLNs, low power and lossy networks, and also examined the requirements by examining various application areas of LLNs, like we did, like for example in smart homes, in smart farms, and so on and so on, and essentially proposed a common routing protocol for these kinds of networks. So this is the so-called RPL protocol, which however is pronounced Ripple, the routing protocol for low power and lossy networks. This is where the R, the P, and the L come from, and this is the Ripple protocol that we are going to discuss now. So after examining, as we said, the different RFCs and the different protocols available in the literature and the different application scenarios, the group ended up with a set of common requirements, and at the end, after of course agreeing, they established a minimalistic set of criteria. These are five criteria. We have table scalability as the number of nodes increases, and we saw here, for example, DSR had the problem here. We have loss response when a node or a link becomes unavailable. If the protocol recovers from such a loss, without creating a lot of overhead, the overall cost of the control packets, and then the ability to assign properties on links, the so-called link cost, and the ability to assign properties on nodes, the so-called node cost. So essentially, the ability to use these costs in order to use different optimization functions. So here we can see the evaluations of done over seven RFCs in terms of this criteria, the role criteria, as we say them. And you can see that essentially none of these protocols clearly pass all these criteria. And this led the group to the decision to introduce yet another protocol, which however builds upon the work introduced and the concept introduced in the previous RFCs and the literature. And this essentially created the Ripple protocol, which now moves from directed acyclic graphs that we saw in TORA and the Ringley Versal algorithms to the so-called destination-oriented DAGs, the DOT DAGs, that are rooted in a single destination, which now can have multiple, as we saw earlier, paths or they can have and of course they have a single route. So essentially the Ripple protocol follows link reversal, follows TORA, follows this approach where the nodes coordinate in order to create a DODAG. And this is an example. We have the so-called node rank, which is the height of the node within a DODAG, always with respect to the root. So the root signified in green here has zero rank. The nodes that are directly connected to this node have a rank of one. Those connected to the immediate neighbors of the root, so the neighbors of the neighbors of the root, get rank two, and so on and so forth. So why a DODAG? Because essentially a tree is simpler, but it's not including the redundancy protocols that we need. And why do they decided to go with DODAGs? Essentially because here we are designing a protocol, a routing protocol for sensor networks, for wireless sensor networks. And by studying the different application scenario and by studying the requirements of this scenario, it is realized that the majority of the traffic is many to one. So we have sensors that are more or less executing similar tasks. They are transmitting messages, similar messages that are targeting the gateway. And in this way enter the core internet. So we have many to one communication from all the sensors towards the gateway, one of the gateways of the network, in case that we have many. And in other cases we also have one to many, where essentially we want to modify the properties, the operation of the sensors, and we want to let's say notify all the nodes of the network, query the network, and so on. While let's say point to point is not very common, of course we have scenarios where there are actuators that are operating the lights and so on, but essentially these are not in the majority, let's say, of the scenario. And in this case the decision was made to go with DODAGs in order to let's say promote these kinds of message exchanges. And the approach here is to build this topology. The terminology here is called instance, where the nodes set up routes that are essentially forming these DODAGs, and these routes are optimized based on a specific optimization function. Essentially now, given these DODAGs, we have traffic flow going upwards and downwards. So when we have one to many, we have downwards communication, while when we have, so this is also in distributed computing, the notion of broadcast. One node is broadcasting to all the nodes of the network, while all the nodes of the networks are converged cast a message to a single node, and this is upwards communication. While point to point essentially is realized by a combination of up and down. And of course the root of the DAG is playing a central role to such kind of message exchanges. The idea is that we might have many instances of Ripple, and this follows the concept of multi-topology routing. So here we have instances that have different optimization objectives when they are forming the DODAG. They can use one or more metrics, like we discussed earlier, about energy efficiency, about latency, reliability of the links, volatility of the nodes, and so on. So depending on the application, we can follow, we can use different RPL instances. At the end, each application might maintain its own RPL instance. And within an instance, there might be multiple DODAGs. So you see there is a large level of freedom. And of course, a node may belong to more than one instance. And in this way, a node might choose not to participate in a given application, and in this way save resources and by being excluded from these message exchanges. So packets, control packets, and of course data packets are tagged to follow a specific instance, which of course, as we said, is defined at the application layer. In this way, we don't have loops between different instances, and as we said, the network may run multiple instances concurrently with different optimization criteria. The control messages essentially are five. There are also some extra five for security purposes. Here we have the DIO packet, the information object that describes how to discover an RPL instance. It is similar to the root request, let's say, control message in some sense. It is used to learn configuration parameters from neighboring nodes and select a DODAG parent. Then we have the information solicitation that is used in some sense to respond to DIO packets. And then we have also the DAO packets that are advertising a destination. They are used to propagate destination information upwards from the nodes to the root. And we also have destination acknowledgements for the advertisement object. So we have AX, DAO AX messages. These are the four basic packets of Ripple. And as we said, there are also some additional ones for security purposes that, of course, is very important, but we will not discuss at this point. Now, how do we construct a DODAG? Nodes periodically send these DIO messages at the local level. So these are used to reinforce the stability of links and detect inconsistencies between the information held at the different nodes. This also controls the rate of exchange of the DIO messages. Here we are using the trickle protocol that we discussed earlier in order to reduce the periodicity of the exchange of the DIO messages. Now, by listening to these DIOs, we can help the node join a new DODAG or update an existing DODAG. And then additional DIS messages are used to carry out information related to these DIOs in order to reinforce specific selections. And of course, node choose parents by minimizing specific path costs. So this is an example. Here we have, as you can see in green, the root A is the root of the DODAG. We have for each node one link that is selected to be the one that is within selected for this DODAG. and this points towards the parent of the node. We also have the rank of the node. And you can see that there are also some other links which are not used in this DODAG. And of course, they are not used because their cost function is higher than the one that is already picked. So you see that C, for example, has a connection to B with a path cost of 1, since B has a connection to A with a path cost of 1. So the resulting path has a cost of 2, which is lower than a direct connection to A or through D. This could be, for example, stability, for example, of the wireless channel, the noise experienced when trying to communicate directly to A. So in this way, C decides to go through B. And in this way, you see how at the end we have a DODAG with different nodes and how they are connected. Interestingly, in Ripple, nodes hold no knowledge about their children. They only know how they are connected upwards. That's how the protocol works. They of course agree on the costs of the links, as we said, and then of course they hold information on their height. So now downwards routes are based on this DAO methods. Nodes inform their parents of their presence and reachability by sending a DAO message. So these are the messages that go, let's say, from the boundaries of the network towards the center, towards the root, and gradually the nodes get notified about their children when we need to have, let's say, a downwards traffic flow, when we have to carry out one-to-many information exchange. Now, here, Ripple introduces the notion of nodes that do participate. They are repeaters, as we discussed, but due to very limited memory capabilities, they cannot hold many information. They are incapable, as we say, of maintaining routing state. So essentially, they just attach a next hop address and nothing else. So you can see here the nodes in blue, they are the so-called stateless nodes. They are only capable of storing information about their parent nodes and their height, while the red nodes are also capable of holding information about their children. So now H sends a DAO message to F by indicating the existence of H. F propagates this directly to I because I is the next hop, but does not hold any information regarding this DAO. The same goes with G. G sends the DAO to its parent, that's F. Again, F forwards the DAO directly to I, and similarly F also sends a DAO to I, and in this way I learns that it has three children, F, H and G. It knows that H and G have a higher rank than F due to the DAO message. And this information now is aggregated and forwarded to C that will eventually send it to A. And in this way, A manages to reconstruct to a certain extent the structure of the tree given these DAO messages. Now, in case that we have a repair, here there are different approaches. We have a local repair where a parent is chosen with a lower rank. So when the connection between, let's say, G and C is damaged, now G will choose a parent with a lower rank, which is should be somewhere in the vicinity. If this does not exist, then we have to move towards a so-called global repair, where now we use sequence numbers in order to keep the part of the network that is still functioning and is operating without problems, and the part that is disconnected, as we can see in the example G, F, H and I, essentially we are increasing the rank towards infinity, so that then essentially the nodes realize that they are completely disconnected, and it is better to reconstruct the DODAG rather than trying to repair the one that was pre-existing. Now, if of course this is not the case, if G has a connection, for example, to B or a connection to D, then this is avoided, and we follow a simple correction without going through this process. So, to summarize, a new protocol is introduced, the so-called ripple protocol, that is optimized for many-to-one and one-to-many traffic. This is something new compared to the protocols presented previously. The idea is the routing state is minimized. We have stateless nodes that have to store only simple few parameters and their parents. And then there are also some more powerful nodes that are able to introduce additional functionality to facilitate the operation of the network. And then, of course, we have the ability to optimize the operation of the network based on properties assigned to nodes and also to links. Then these link failure mechanisms essentially allow us to limit the propagation of the changes to the local network, unless of course there is no way to do that, and clearly we need to have a broader involvement of nodes further away from where the failure occurred. Ripple is a protocol that is of course presented as an RFC. So in the website you will see the RFC of Ripple, and this now is a standard of internet. It has been moved to this category. It is not an experimental algorithm. We have protocols, we have implementation of Ripple in products, and of course we have different implementations, as we have saw have seen in Riot OS, and in different network stacks. So you see that here we have people from academia, like Lewis. We have people from established companies like Cisco, like Arcroc, but we also have people from more focused companies related to wireless sensor networks, like the DAST Networks company. Again, this is a detailed presentation of how Ripple works. You see that this is a very, very detailed standard. It is really long. We have a very clear presentation of the different aspects of the protocol. And also we have different RFCs connected to this one that are discussing, for example, different kind of metrics. They are discussing different kind of security extensions, trust extensions, and so on and so forth. So of course, it is for those that go that want to go into the administration and setup and deployment of wireless networks that are, let's say, IPv6 enabled. Understanding how RPL works, of course, is important to debug the operation of the network, to optimize the operation of the network. And with this, we conclude the first part of this lecture, and now we'll move to some simple demonstrations of how Ripple works using Riot OS and using IoT Lab. So let's go to IoT Lab. Here we will start a new experiment with M3 nodes. Let's pick some node at Saclay. For example, let's add 6 nodes. And now we need to upload the firmware. There is, in fact, a tutorial. Under the tutorials, you can see here for the Riot OS under M3 nodes, we have this running RPL routing on Ripple routing, sorry, on M3 nodes. We don't want to have IPv6 low PAN enabled. We don't want to have public addresses. This is not for now. We will deal with that later. We just want to check how we can have Ripple running with Riot on M3 nodes. So here we need to use the basic Riot example on that uses this JNRC. Let's have a look. GitHub, Riot. Let's go into the examples. We are going to use this very, very simple networking example, which essentially is using Ripple in order to connect the different nodes. And offers, of course, this UDP service that we see here so that we can connect the two instances. We are not going to use the tap. We are going to use the real nodes provided by IoT Lab. So the first thing that we need to do is to SSH to Saclay, where, of course, we have all the necessary tools in order to compile the Riot example for the specific hardware. And we also get the source code, which is under this directory. And here we specify that we are using this board, M3, in order to compile the example. So this is the code, and now I want this code in my laptop, so I will SCP this from Saclay, here it is, into my laptop. Okay, so it's not Saclay, it is Saclay IoT Lab, the dash.info, like that. Yes, well, sorry for that. Okay, what's the problem? Yes, as a matter of fact, this is located. Actually, it's here. I don't know why I'm making myself. It is under examples, networking. So let me copy this. I think it's easier and faster than trying to correct the previous one, and I will just change this to my login. Okay, so this is the binary, which is now available on my local machine. As you see, it's relatively small. So here I will go to these six M3 nodes, and I will use this firmware. And here it is, it has been uploaded in L format. And I would like to have this. I think 20 minutes are enough. So let's submit this experiment. Submission is in process. We are waiting. Let's go into this. This is launching. While it is launching, let me reconnect to my Saclay account. And it is still launching. Let's wait. Okay, now it is running. We are ready. Okay, so given that this is ready, what we are going to do now, we are going to use the serial aggregator. This is a tool that allows us to connect directly to all the nodes. And now we can issue a command to all the nodes of the experiment. So if I issue this command, RPL init 7, it will create a new request, a new instance to initialize RPL for our network configuration number 7. So before that, let's go just to a single node. I'm using M31 because essentially we are given these nodes in the experiment. So we have M31, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. These are the six nodes that were given to us. So now here, if I specify the ID of a given node, this command will be sent to the specific node and only to the specific node. So you can see here the response that we receive, and at the beginning, each line is has a prefix of a unique ID, the time stamp, and then the ID of the node. So here you see that our 15.4 interface is under ID number 7, and here we have the hardware address and the other parameters, like for example the channel 26. And so on and so forth, and the IPv6 address. Okay, so this is the seventh interface, and we want to send a command to all the nodes, to all six nodes, to initialize Ripple using this interface number 7. So you see now that this command is sent to all the nodes, and we get a response from the nodes mixed, first number 5, number 1, 2, 6, 3, and 4. So you see we have six commands and the responses. So now let's go back to the tutorial. We have initialized a Ripple to each one of these nodes. So now we have essentially simple nodes, and we want to specify that our first, let's follow this example. It's slightly different. Let's say that node number 6, we want to make it the root of our Ripple .dag. So here we configure interface 7 to add a new address, this IPv6 address. So you see here that we have added this address to interface 7, and of course we can request to see what's the situation with this interface, and you see here that we have one new address for this specific interface. And now again we instruct node 6 to become the root of the first instance using this address. So this will make now I'm getting this could not add .dag instance. This is weird now. Maybe because I typed replu root. I made a mistake clearly because yes, I typed wrong the address. So it is 2008 DB8. So whenever I don't copy paste, I make mistakes. Again, I get an error. Great. What is the error due to? Because I initially typed in a wrong address. So the problem, we can use the arrows, of course, to go up and down. Let's put here, there. Unable to add the IPv4. Okay, so I completely destroyed this. Let me quickly restart this by init 7. So now we are back. No, I restarted Ripple, but I did not restart the nodes. Okay, so now I'm running out of I would reboot the nodes. Okay, so I restarted, sorry for that. I'm back here. Let's try one more time. If config 7, yes, we have restarted the node. Okay, so let's init Ripple to all the nodes, and now I will copy paste to make sure I'm not making any mistake. Okay, let's check this. If config 7. Indeed, we have the address, the correct address, added to the 7th interface, to the interface with ID 7 of M36. And now we are going to request Ripple to set up instance 1 with root node, this node. So you see now that we have successfully added a new Ripple.dag into instance 1, and this is the root of the .dag. So in the background now, Ripple has started propagating this around the network. And if we use just Ripple, we will see here from node 5 that we have an instance table. We have a parent table, so this have been initialized. And now we see that instance 1, which is related to interface 7, is connected to this, includes this .dag. And the rank of the node is 512. Essentially, in RiotOS, the rank means, as we see here, that there is the parent of this node has is the root node. So let's check this address. This is the parent of node 5. And if we go up, we see that this is the address indeed of node 6. And now, again, we can use the same command also for the root node. Here we have an instance, but we don't have a parent because this is the parent, and this is the .dag, and the rank is 556. So this is the rank of the root. And here we see that this is connected directly to the root. And like that, we can continue. We can also request from 6 to provide a list of the roots that have been identified. So here you see that we have a root to these nodes here via these nodes. So more or less this is a relatively flat network. Now, of course, we can use the tools implemented like ping to send ICMP packets from node 5 to node 6, and you see here that we have this packet exchange with these three messages taking about 10 seconds to arrive. And of course we can do the same thing with the other nodes of the network, so we can see that also node 1 is directly connected to the root, so we can again use ping 6 to send ICMP packets to the root. We expect to have similar delays since these are just one hop packets. Now, we can also check out the address of node 1. So this is the address of node 1. And we can exchange point-to-point messages between node 5 and node 1. And these are now packets that essentially go up to the root, and then from the root they go down. We can also try to repeat the code presented inside this tutorial. So we can set up, for example, a UDP server in node 1, listening to port 888. As you can see here, this is a command sent only to node 1. And then, of course, we can send a packet to this node. So this is the address of the node, and we can go to even another one and use send to this address, to this port, a hello message. So you see now that 3 is sending this packet, and we have a success. And you see M node 1 has successfully received this packet. This is the output from node 1, and this is the source address. This is the address of M3. We can verify it from here. Indeed, this is the address of 3. So we received an address, a message from 3. And as you can see, we have this message exchange, and here is the actual message exchange. So you see that now, using Ripple, we can have applications that exchange messages either from many to one or one to many. Of course, we can do the same from any other node in the network. We can repeat the same command. We can actually execute the same command from all the nodes of the network just by omitting the first address. And you see that we get a success, and of course M31 successfully acknowledges the receipt of the message. So this is the tutorial. You can of course try out different tutorials. It's not necessary to run this specific tutorial. You can also try out this scenario using the MQTT example that you did with Andrea over this Ripple protocol. in case that you have a multi-hop scenario. Okay, so that's it. I will now stop this experiment. There is no reason to hold up these resources. I will just cancel this experiment so that I am done. Okay, so with this we conclude this lecture, and of course we will continue the discussion through Google Meet or through Slack, or of course through the Google Classroom. So thanks for listening, and see you soon. Bye-bye.